if you are next to an open chair, I want you to put your hand on that chair at this time. Or if there's an open chair in front of you, can you put your hand on an open chair that's in front of you? We'd love just to have a hand on the chairs that are empty. And again, there's not a whole lot of this morning, but as your hand is on that chair, I want you to imagine the person, the name of the person that you put on that prayer wall. Imagine that person, that you develop this relationship with them, and they actually come and sit in that chair at some point. When God moves them, when the Spirit moves, that person comes and sits in that chair. And I want to pray over that chair at this time as your hands are on those chairs. Let's pray. God, thank you so much for this church. It's great just that, God, you want your house to be full, and we are full this morning, Lord. Father, we also want to see the people that we're praying for come to a restored relationship in Jesus Christ, Father. And Lord, bless our coffee. Bless our conversations. Bless the people that we're praying for, Father. And just let us be light and love. Let us listen to them, God, not preach to them. Not act like, as we said last week, like we have our act all together and they don't, Lord. Let us just let the light and love of Jesus flow through us, God. And we pray, God, for those people that when we invite those people, that they will just come and fill these chairs, and we'll have to open up our curtain there and open up our overflow seating, God. We just want to see you move in this place. Thank you for letting us be a part of your amazing work. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. Amen. So, if you can't see, what is this behind me here?
Paper.
One of our artists has worked on this, and in the middle is two coffee cups, which is our theme. So this won't be here forever, but it's a good reminder that, and there's butterflies that are all around that represent a new life, a new creation in Jesus Christ. So we are praying through the power of the risen Lord who is no longer on the cross, that through the people that we're loving and praying for, and through those conversations, that there will be new life just as we have experienced new life in Jesus Christ. So thank you, and I hope you'll just take a peek at that and reflect on that. So I want to talk further about restoration today. Restoration is our theme for the year. Our mission is to invest in people, to ignite our towns, and to restore people to God. And one of the most important areas where restoration is needed is for people who live in extreme poverty. They need physical restoration, and they need spiritual restoration. When I say, just imagine for a moment the face of a poor person, what comes to your mind? If I say, if you just think of a picture of someone who really is impoverished, what do you imagine? Do you imagine a homeless person maybe on the street? Do you think of maybe some of the pictures that we see of, the emaciated, just really sick, starving people in other countries? You've seen pictures of the children. I was driving home last week, and just a few houses from my house, there was a man that was sitting on the curb, and you could tell by his dress that he was homeless. But he also had mental illness, and mental illness sometimes goes along with homelessness in our country. He had something called catatonic behavior. I don't know if you've heard of that. It's actually kind of scary. But for some reason, his body had froze, not like ice frozen, but it was perfectly still. If you've ever seen people on the street sometimes dress up in tin, paint themselves silver and they freeze in a position, that because of his mental illness, he just froze. They don't even blink. Their body, somehow their mind just takes over their body. So he was crouched in a very awkward position, and he was catatonic. He was just completely stiff. And catatonic represents not just the outside, but the inside of a person who is impoverished, a person who is hungry, a person who's starving. And inside, they're frozen as well. Their emotions are frozen. Jesus has a powerful message that if you live in the kingdom of God, your responsibility is to care for those people, to care for the poor, to care for the oppressed. A definition of poverty that I heard this week, I wanted to read it to you. It says, poverty is a cancerous, thieving parasite plaguing the destitute, but it is not invincible. Poverty is an overwhelming, frightening, and debilitating beast, but it can be defeated. Poverty is an opportunity to provide an opportunity. Now, that definition I want us to roll with for a moment. Poverty is an opportunity. We have an opportunity presented for us to give someone an opportunity. Because when you are poor, when you just, you have no funds, when you don't know where you're going to get your food, and you don't have shoes on your feet, you have just a cloth over your head, you don't have a home, you are absolutely broke, you have nothing to sell to gain food for the day, you have no opportunity. You have no choices. Now, most of us in this room have always had at least some choices because we have had some means of finances. Finances provide choice. And Jesus says we are the ones to give those people an opportunity. And he takes it very seriously. In fact, Jesus says this, that this is a heaven or hell issue. Now, there's a lot of issues that people talk about in churches and in spirituality. Very few does Jesus say it is a heaven or hell issue. Jesus says if you take care of the poor, if you feed the hungry, if you give water to the thirsty, if you welcome the strangers, if you care for these people, you have a heart for these people, you will be welcomed into the kingdom of God. If you do not, you will not be welcomed into the kingdom of God. It's very simple. There's not a lot of talk, not a lot of discussion. It's just very, very clear. It doesn't matter what you think about poor people. It doesn't matter what you say about poor people. It doesn't matter what you feel about poor people. Jesus says what matters is, what are you doing? What are you doing to help people who have far less than you have? Even if you have a heart for them, but you do not provide for them, Jesus says that is very dangerous. So listen to the powerful, powerful picture that Jesus paints today in the Bible. I want you to read it. Matthew 25. Turn to Matthew chapter 25. Verse 31. Hear the word of God this morning. When the Son of Man comes in glory, and all the angels with him, he will sit on the throne in heavenly glory, and all the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate the people one from another, as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. He will put the sheep on his right and the goats on his left. So I want you to imagine now all the nations of the world, all the nations, all the countries of the world, one day will be gathered before the throne of God, and Jesus is sitting before the throne in glory. And he's going to place you on one side. He's going to place you with sheep, or he's going to place you with goats. And listen to the difference. Then the king will say to those on his right, Come you who are blessed by my Father, and take your inheritance, the kingdom prepared for you since the creation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you invited me in. And I needed clothes, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you looked after me. I was in prison, and you came to visit me. And then the righteous will answer him, they're kind of scratching their head. They're thinking back. Now, I know by this time my memory's bad, but I don't remember doing that for you, Jesus. I don't remember that time. Jesus, when you were hungry or when you were thirsty, or when did I come visit you? So this is what they say. Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you something to drink? When did we see you a stranger and invite you in, or needing clothes and clothe you? When, Lord, when did we see you sick or in prison and come visit you? And the king will reply, listen, I tell you the truth. Whoever you did for one of the least of these, whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers of mine, you did for me. When you did it for them, you did it for me. Come, welcome in. Welcome to your inheritance. From before the earth was even created, I had a special place for people like you. For people with hearts. For people who care enough to do something about the poor in this world. Those who are hungry. Those who are thirsty. It goes on to say, I don't have this on the screen. I'm just going to read it. If you have your Bibles, follow along. It says, then he will say to those on his left, depart from me, you who are cursed, into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. Whoa! Okay, wake up. I don't want to hear that. I don't want to be numbered with those. Man, these are tough words of Jesus. Depart from me, I never knew you. And there's a place prepared for you. Eternal punishment. It's where Satan reigns and his angels. And then he will say to those, after he says that, verse 42, he says, for I was hungry and you gave me nothing to eat. I was thirsty and you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger and you did not invite me in. I needed clothes and you did not clothe me. And I was sick and in prison and you did not look after me. And they also will scratch their heads, drop their jaws, and be in amazement. Wait. Oh, you've got it wrong. Well, when, Jesus? I don't remember. I don't remember, Jesus, you being hungry. I don't remember you being in prison. I don't remember when I, and he says, when you did this unto the least of these, my sisters, my brothers, you did this to me. This morning is about hearts and action for the least of these. It's very challenging. It's very sobering. So who do you see? What type of people? And how do you react towards them? There's a part of me that wants to shy away. A part of me that wonders if maybe they're just taking advantage of the situation. I've seen more people over here at the parking lot in Rouse and El Segundo now. But you know what I've seen? It's not just men. I've seen women, and they're holding their babies. Or they've got their child, two children next to them, and they're homeless, and they're saying, will you do anything to help me? Do we drive by? Do we stop? Do we look the other way? Do we even care? Now, here's a challenge. This is overwhelming. It's overwhelming. What can I do, right? What can I do about this problem? I mean, look, come on the news every night we've got talking about open borders and You know, let's have open borders because we need to care for those people. And you got people saying, let's build a wall and let's not build a wall. We need law and order. And, you know, we're going to build a wall, but we're going to have a big door. And then we've got the whole refugee crisis and thousands and hundreds and tens of thousands of people who are looking for a home. And then we think, how do we respond? How do we handle this? And I'm not judging anyone regardless of which side of that you are on, because I think there's just some political plays that are in the move there. I think what Jesus is more concerned about is your heart and what are you willing to do rather than what are you willing to just talk about or take sides in. The least, he calls them the least of these. We live in a country of the most of these. And praise God for that, by the way. Because now he has given us, what? Opportunity to give opportunities. Say that with me. Opportunity to give opportunities to who? The least of these. My brothers and sisters. The hungry. The thirsty. The sick. The stranger. The poor, the imprisoned. What will we do? Well, I had to look at some statistics. I want to share them with you this morning just about poverty in the world today. Worldwide, there are 600 million children who live in extreme poverty. 600 million children. Now, extreme poverty means that they woke up this morning and have no idea if they will have a meal, most likely not. Children, they don't have food. Extreme poverty, no shoes on their feet. Almost half the world, over 3 billion people, live on less than $2.50 a day. Imagine that. $2.50 a day, 3 billion people. So if there are 6 billion people that populate this planet, 3 billion of those are living in extreme poverty. Well, how about America? 50 million Americans are defined as living in poverty and hungry. A lot of their meals are covered, but they don't know where a lot of their meals will come from in a given year. 17 million children go to bed hungry and not getting the food and proper nutrition that they need. I found a survey interesting that I read. It was conducted in the country of Niger, 2002, so it's a while ago. But here's what they asked the poor people. They wanted to say, okay, we think of poverty and we define it one way, but if you actually are living in poverty, how do you define it? And here's what they said. First of all, poverty is dependence. Always having to seek out others or to work for somebody else. You are not self-dependent, you live in constant dependence on other people. Marginalization. A poor person who is alone, has no support, doesn't feel involved in anything, and is never consulted. Marginalized. But you don't ask advice from a person that is that poor. What do they have to offer? That's how they feel. They're never consulted. Scarcity is how they would define poverty. Having nothing to eat, lacking the means to meet clothing and financial needs, and having nothing to sell. I can't get food because I can't scrape together even shoes to sell to get food. They feel restricted rights and freedoms. Incapacity, the incapacity to make decisions to feed or to clothe oneself or to act on one's own initiative. So, how do they feel? They have no voice. They have no rights. They have no advocate. They have no support system at all. No food, no clean water, no clothes to wear. Jesus says, we are to care for them. We are to take care of these type people. We are to love them. We are the ones to do something about it. And if we don't, who will? If Christians won't, it's not the country's, it's not the state's responsibility to do this. It is our responsibility to do this. One person at a time. One Christian at a time. Speak up, the Bible says, for those who cannot speak for themselves. This is Proverbs 31, 8 and 9. Speak up for the rights of those who are destitute. Speak up and judge fairly. Defend the rights of the poor and the needy. This is so important to Jesus. Jesus says, this is top of my list. You want to live and be a part of the kingdom of God? You got to get love. It's the most important thing. And you got to care for the needy. Do that. Welcome in to the kingdom of God. Don't do that. Watch out. So, I hear these words and I just think, what can I do? I mean, really, what can I do? This is enormous. I heard the story this past week of an elderly man who went down to the beach. And he got to the beach. So imagine you get down to El Segundo Beach and you look down towards Palos Verdes and you're standing in the sand. And as far as you can see, there has been some type of a tidal surge that has washed up thousands and thousands of starfish. Thousands of starfish. As far as the eye can see. And then the tide goes out, and the starfish are burning in the sun. And this old man is walking along, and he reaches down, and he picks up a starfish. And he walks down to the water and he tosses the starfish far enough out that it can be refreshed and have life. And a little boy is up there just kind of watching this man. And finally he gets up the nerve and he goes down and he's like, Mister, what are you doing? You know, look at this. There's thousands of starfish all down this whole beach. And you just grab that one. What type of a difference can you make? He takes a couple steps and he bends down and he takes another starfish, tosses it into the ocean, and he says, I made a difference for that one. That's the call of Christ. One, the power of one. The power of one person caring and loving one person. And so I want to encourage you today to do just that. What can we do? Start with one person and care for them. Brittany's singing on the praise team this morning, and Christian and Brittany are leading something for the first time this year called A Walk for Compassion. It's actually the first time in Los Angeles, Compassion International. And the goal is to eradicate child poverty. And we at Hilltop have said, this year, that is our goal. That's what we want to do. We want to take part in eradicating child poverty. How can we do that? One person at a time. So, Brittany is going to be out front, and I want to encourage, that is something you can do. You know, whether you're, you know, just a guest here or you know, from live in a different place, you can join us in this and we'll give you information. But this walk is going to be in May, but I hope you'll look at this information beforehand and see how you can come alongside professional organizations that have made this their goal. We also have our homeless family program, Family Promise, right? Monica's going to share a little bit about how you can find out information on that in just a bit this morning. But what we have done is we've said we're going to make it our goal as a church to help homeless families with children that live in the area to get off the streets. And we have an organization that we're going to come alongside to give them shelter and to feed them. It's something you can do. It's a start. It's a place to start. So I would encourage you before you leave this morning to, we're going to give some information and then, but maybe it's your own way. You know, I don't know how you want to do that. All I know is Jesus says we need to do that. This is something we have to do. And start today. I also want us to think in spiritual terms this morning, because Jesus says, when I was a stranger, you invited me in. When I was a stranger, you invited me in. And Jesus also said, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness' sake. We need both. We need to do both. We need to take care of the physical needs of people and realize Jesus also calls us to point people to him to take care of the spiritual needs of people. When I was a stranger, you invited me in, and I want to encourage you to really just get on board with praying for the people on the prayer wall, having coffee and conversations, inviting them out, just not to preach to them again, but just to love them and let your light shine, and then invite them in to come and be a part of what God is doing in this place. As Michael said earlier, this is a wonderful church. Each of you needs to be a part of this mission, this vision of restoration. Each person has a place to, a part to play in this role. And so let's do it, church. Let's not leave and just say, oh, that's really great. Let's do something about it. One person at a time, because collectively the power of one is that we can take care of thousands and tens of thousands of people if we'll join in this together. Are you with me? Let's do it. How can I do it? Take a little step and watch God multiply that step. Let's pray. God, thank you for this morning. Thank you for your heart, Lord. Thank you for caring for us, and thank you when we were strangers to you, God, you invited us into relationship with you. Father, where would we be without you? Help us, Lord, to share that love, to share that light. Father, we read that we have an inheritance this morning. Jesus said, we have an inheritance that's out of this world, Lord. What would you allow us to inherit as your children, Father? And may we share that inheritance with as many people as we can, Father. Thank you for that, Lord. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to continue our worship service, but you probably can't see this, but I promise you it's here. I have a little starfish. And Debbie Hudson is going to have these available to you. If you would like to take a little starfish with you to remind you, I encourage you to do that, that we're going to be a church and people who care for the poor. That's what Hilltop's all about. So, thank you. Bye.